Hello, I'm Lucinda Bateman. We're here today to discuss cognitive impairment in fibromyalgia and ME/CFS. Before we start specifically with cognitive impairment, I want to remind you of the basic approach to management of these illnesses. First, you need to have undergone a good workup with your clinician and differential diagnosis to identify and address any other illness or aspects of illness that need to be under good management. Second is it's very important for you to understand how to pace your activity to prevent symptom escalation. This is preventive activity management to avoid the push-crash cycle. Only you can direct that. Then I have five major aspects of illness that we address depending on the severity in your case. Achieving restorative sleep, getting the most balanced mental health and cognition possible. We're going to take the piece out of cognition. Get pain under control. Achieve the best fitness possible within the confines of your illness. And if you have orthostatic intolerance, you should be working to address that as well. So today we're going to take out that small piece and talk about cognition, brain fog, and cognitive impairment. Oh man, cognitive impairment is a common complaint in both fibromyalgia and ME/CFS. Patients report brain fog, trouble word finding, reduced short-term memory and attention, concentration, slowed thinking, reduced cognitive or processing speed, mild confusion or disorientation, especially sensory overload, inability to process information, and trouble multitasking or organizing, which we sometimes call executive function. Just to show you how prominent cognitive impairment is in these criteria, I'll show you that in the 2010 fibromyalgia criteria, cognitive complaints can contribute to as many as 3 points on the score that requires only 5 to make a diagnosis of fibromyalgia. In terms of ME/CFS, cognitive impairment is considered one of the core symptoms that either cognitive impairment or orthostatic intolerance count as the fourth core criteria. So many, many people have cognitive impairment. And I would add that people with orthostatic intolerance also complain of cognitive symptoms. So it ends up being a required and core criteria for ME/CFS as well. This is just one example from the IOM report published in 2015, quoting a paper by Lenny Jason, showing that these are the number of people with ME/CFS who are the blue bars, compared to controls, who are the red bars, who complain of these symptoms of at least moderate severity and at least half the time during the last 6 months. And you can see across the bottom, problems remembering, difficulty expressing thoughts, difficulty paying attention, slowness of thought, absent-mindedness, and difficulty understanding are all dramatically more common than in healthy controls if they are scored as at least moderate in severity and present at least half of the time, which is what chronic illness is. So the cognitive impairment of ME/CFS and fibro is often difficult to measure objectively. Neuropsychometric testing or cognitive testing is pretty expensive, and sometimes insurance won't cover it. Most of the typical neurocognitive tests don't really pick up the deficits that we see in ME/CFS and fibro. And it's important for me to mention that brain fog and cognitive impairment are not dementia. And it is not your IQ or your intelligence. Those seem to be intact in our illnesses. What we do see is slowed information processing, and especially as the most important documented cognitive deficit in ME/CFS. Difficulty with timed tests because of that slowed processing and difficulty multitasking, which is actually moving quickly from task to task. So if the cognition is somewhat slowed in its processing, then it becomes more difficult to multitask. And in fact, most patients, once they start concentrating, really don't want to move away from it because they might not be able to come back to it. I don't have time to go into all the brain research in ME/CFS, but or fibromyalgia, but I will say that there's quite a bit to show that there's a process going on in the brain that may be impairing cognitive function, causing it to be slowed. We know that activated microglia and astrocytes are present. That's a type of neuroinflammation. We have seen imaging on functional MRI and spin echo MRI in studies showing various changes in the brain. We know that lactate is increased in the fluid in the brain in the ventricles from more than one study. EEG, particularly quantitative EEG, which is all the EEG waves analyzed by a computer to look at differences between ME/CFS patients and from healthy controls, and also the spinal fluid of people with ME/CFS compared to both healthy controls and other chronic illnesses, it looks like a promising area of research to understand what the underlying process might be. Now, microglial cells that I addressed in that first, in the last slide, are cells in the central nervous system that play a role for your immune system or your innate immunity. Inflammation by these cells can cause or contribute to widespread pain of fibromyalgia and underlie the cognitive slowing of ME/CFS, or the exhaustion and the pain as well, and can compromise or reduce normal function in any area of the brain where the inflammation occurs. The problem is we can't see it on MRI, and we don't have a lot of brains to be dissecting at this point to try to understand what the underlying mechanisms might be. Dr. Jared Younger has provided a great deal of hope for people with fibromyalgia, especially with his studies of how naltrexone or low-dose naltrexone can interact with glial cells in the brain to reduce their inflammatory response, at least in some areas of the brain, and in so doing may reduce the pain in many people with fibromyalgia. This is just a picture of a microglial cell. This is a little cartoon showing why this matters. On the left are the normal brain cells, the neuron up in the left corner with its long axon traveling down to where it goes to your spinal cord. Then the red and the yellow and the purple cells are cells in your surrounding the neurons that are there to protect them, particularly microglia that are red. And I think you've heard of, maybe not heard of oligodendrocytes, the purple ones, but these create the myelin sheath around the axon that protects it. If your immune system starts to damage the myelin sheath, that can create an illness that we call multiple sclerosis. But if you look at the microglia on the left with its long, feathery tentacles coming out, you can see the difference on the right. When the microglia become activated, they get short and fat and angry and start to release their inflammatory molecules. And we think maybe this happens because there's a little bit of a break in the blood-brain barrier. So that kind of snaky looking thing in the middle of the picture is an enlarged blood vessel showing that if some of your immune cells, you know, get out and cross over into the central nervous system, that they might create an inflammatory response. They may be going there to try to help with something, but they're foreign to across the blood-brain barrier. So this is just a bit of a schematic to show you how this inflammatory response might be set up in the brain and lead to a number of illnesses that we call neuroimmune illnesses. And we think ME/CFS may fall in this category. So a little reminder, of the general principles of supportive management, how many of these do you think relate to cognitive function? Well, look at all the potential contributors to cognitive dysfunction. Other conditions that you have can create brain fog and fatigue, such as hypothyroidism or low B12. If you're not pacing and managing your activity, you can have more brain fog, more cognitive impairment. Pain, disturbed sleep, mental health conditions, and being very deconditioned and sedentary can all negatively impact your cognition. So, oh, and also orthostatic intolerance, because it causes reduced brain flow. So that you can see that this general approach is very important for improving the clarity of your thought and reducing brain fog. So because we don't know all the specific causes, and they may vary from person to person, it's important for you to address all the potential contributors and causes of brain fog and cognitive slowing. Think about medications that might be fogging your memory or making you sleepy. Medications we use for sleep, pain, anxiety, migraine. You shouldn't just take medicines, you should assess them and make sure that the benefit is worth it compared to the potential side effects. You should improve your sleep, because chronic sleep disturbances can cause more brain fog. Secondary mental health conditions, especially anxiety, can just cause those circuits to jam. So becoming more calm, addressing your stress, and working on mental health conditions should improve the clarity of your thought, especially if you can do it without the use of heavy medications. Orthostatic intolerance and other causes of reduced cerebral blood flow can definitely impact cognition. We think maybe that low cellular energy production itself in the brain, especially in ME/CFS, may be contributing to the cognitive impairment, and that the capacity for function is reduced. So if we push too hard and demand more from those brain cells, then it causes additional impairment. And I'm certain that post-exertional malaise, or the consequences of pushing too hard, can definitely improve, or sorry, can worsen cognitive function. So, you know, the solutions, probably apparent as we went through that, but minimizing your medicines, especially during the day, continue working on your sleep, your mental health, improve your blood flow to the brain, engage in pacing, and avoid severe and prolonged post-exertional malaise by adequately pacing your activity. What about medications that might help brain fog and cognitive impairment? Before we talk about them, I want to emphasize that it's very important that you do the preventive things that we've just discussed to reduce brain fog before you start using medications alone to treat it. But there are medications that can help some people. Wellbutrin, or bupropion as a generic, can be helpful sometimes for focus and concentration, and is not sedating. Sometimes we use stimulants such as Ritalin or Adderall to help with focus and concentration, but these medicines can also make you feel anxious or disrupt your sleep, so they must be observed carefully. And especially the Adderall can raise blood pressure and heart rate, and that may not be the best in some individual circumstances. There are newer drugs for daytime somnolence that are called Provigil and Nuvigil. That might be the names that you remember. These are more gentle in terms of their side effects, but they're much longer acting. So some of my patients have trouble with sleep disruption on these medications, and they may be a little bit difficult to get approval from your insurance unless you meet criteria for obstructive sleep apnea or another FDA-approved indication. There may be some supplements that are helpful. I will give a few examples. They're not supported by strong evidence, but they're interesting and intriguing. Fish oil or omega-3 fatty acids, phosphatidylserine, curcumin from turmeric, B vitamins, and some other antioxidant type vitamins. But certainly not in excess or massive doses, but you would want to be sure that you're not deficient in these and see if they could be helpful for you. What about behavioral strategies for managing your cognitive impairment? That just means, is there something you can do by changing the way you do things to improve your cognition? Number one is you might want to complete your most important cognitive tasks at a time of day when you're most rested, when it's your best time of day, and try not to do it when you're more tired and more cognitively foggy. You should allow more time to accomplish your cognitive tasks and minimize interruptions. You can utilize a day timer or an iPhone or other signaling devices to remind you when you forget things or you feel like you have brain fog. Use those mental cues to help you so you don't feel frustrated and that you can get those things and remember to do those things on time, like taking your pills or doing your exercises or maybe getting to an appointment. It's good to dampen or remove other sensory input to the brain that's distracting or fatiguing to your brain. So I suggest doing your cognitive work in a quiet room, maybe wear earplugs or sound-reducing headphones. You might want to remove the glaring lights and work in lower light if you're light sensitive, and reduce the number of people and chaos and other disruption that's present. I should add that if you have orthostatic intolerance, you might think more clearly when you're in a recliner and your feet are up than when you're standing or when you've been sitting for a prolonged period of time. So just to remind you of our general approach to supportive management for both ME/CFS and fibromyalgia, the first step is pacing and activity management. Next, we address the four legs of the table to try to improve the stability of the tabletop, which is fatigue or unwellness. Right up front is restorative sleep, improvement in severe pain, really working on a healthy mental attitude and reducing your stress, and then trying to engage in as much fitness activities that are possible given the severity and the limitations of your illness. And if you have orthostatic intolerance, you want to understand it and modify it and address it as much as possible. And as we reviewed in this discussion, almost all of those things will improve your cognition. So thank you very much for our discussion today. I hope it's helpful for you as you work on self-management, maybe as you work with your primary physician to improve your illness. And I hope you'll be interested to know that we have other classes that might be helpful for you. Getting and making the right diagnosis, dealing with activity intolerance, pacing and post-exertional malaise, addressing sleep disturbances, working with chronic widespread pain, and understanding and managing orthostatic intolerance. So good luck with that, and I'll leave you with Homer and all the things going on up in his brain.